Thank you for being here this morning. Second Samuel chapter 23. And Brother Smith's not the only one holding his breath this morning. Lady said to me one time, she said, "I can't wait to find out what you have for us." I said, "Me too." But I'll just give you a thought or two this morning. We started out back there in Genesis. We're going to be loosely connected here. Everything, I did not really intend to do this, but everything we preach the past few mornings has been sort of connected with the life of Joseph, and especially with Ephraim and Manasseh. And I want to direct your attention to a fella in a moment in 2 Samuel 23. But I'm going to have to read a few names because it's important that I do for the message. We have in 2 Samuel 23 David's last words. The Bible, it's what Mr. Schofield tells us in my Schofield Bible, Brother Dale. And so we have the last words. You know, the older I get, the harder it is for me to behave in the pulpit. So you pray for me, if you will. We have the last words of David, and then we have an enumeration of David's mighty men. And we dealt with some names earlier this week. Here in verse number 8, we're introduced to a man, Adino the Esnite. Verse 9, Dodo the Ahoite. Verse 11, Shama, the son of Agi the Hararite. We'll read of three men whose names are not given. Then in verse 18, Abishai, the brother of Joab, the son of Zariah. Verse 20, Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, the son of a valiant man of Kabzeel. Verse 22, Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada again. And then beginning in verse 24, Azahel, the brother of Joab, was one of the 30. Elhanan, the son of Dodo of Bethlehem. Shammah the Herodite. Elika the Herodite. Helez the Paltite. Ira the son of Ikesh the Tekoite. Abiezer the Anethothite. Mabunai the Hushathite. Salmon the Ahohite. Meharai, I can't get his name, I've been practicing it. The Netophathite. Helib the son of Baana the Netophathite. Ittai the son of Ribai out of Gibeah of the children of Benjamin. Benaiah the Pirathonite, Hidiah of the brooks of Gaash, Abi Elban, the Arbathite, Asmapheth, the Barhumite. That's enough of that. Now, I'm not reading those for this reason. I'm not reading them for any other reason but this. In every one of these names, we read so-and-so, he is from this nation, or so-and-so, he is the son of this man, or so-and-so, he is of this tribe. But there's a man in our text, his father is not mentioned. His family is not mentioned. His ancestry is not mentioned. The city of his birth is not mentioned. But there is something said about him that interests me. We find him in verse 30, and it says this, Hittai of the brooks of Gaash. Hittai of the brooks of Gaash. And it's interesting to me that in the parallel passage in 1 Chronicles 11, 32, the same man is mentioned, but his name is changed. Here it is Hittai of the brooks of Gaash, but there in 1 Chronicles it is Hurai of the brooks of Gaash. So we have a man whose the name of his father is not what's important about him. The name of his tribe is not what's important about him. Even his own name must not be important because it's found two different ways in two different passages. But the one thing that is constant about him is the brooks of Gaash. So I'm going to preach for a moment on this subject, what happened at the brooks. What happened at the brooks? Father, help us in the next few moments to preach the Word of God. And Lord, help us in our hearts today. Lord, you've been so good to us this morning. You've blessed us and encouraged us, and warmed our hearts, and refreshed our spirits, and I'm so thankful. And I pray you help me, Lord, to say only what needs to be said. I don't want to do anything, Lord, to take away from what's already happened. So I pray this morning you'll just encourage our hearts in the things of God. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen. The reason I would say to you that this Hittai of the Brooks of Gaash would have something to do with our text we used earlier in the week concerning Manasseh and Ephraim, it's because the only time we find the word Gaash, we find it here in this passage. We find it also in the book of Joshua and in the book of Judges. We read in the book of Joshua, and it came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old, and they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Serah, which is in Mount Ephraim, on the north side of the hills of Gaash. So we have in the Bible a hill that is called Gaash. It is the burying place of Joshua, the deliverer, the soldier. Then we have this man who is also a soldier, Hittai, of the Brooks of Gaash. Now, I'm thinking about old Hittai, and if you were to come along and talk to him and ask him about himself, he'd say, well, who's your father, Hittai? He said, well, that doesn't really matter who my father is. You say, well, Hittai, who is your family? He said, well, I love my family, but that's not what I want you to know about me. You might say to him, well, who were your ancestors? He said, well, I had some fine ancestors, but that's not really what I want you to know about me. I said, well, who is your tribe? Well, you know, I come from a good tribe, but that's not really what I want you to know about me. Well, what do you want me to know about you, Hittai? I want you to know about something that happened to me back out down by the brook. What happened to me at the brook is something that has changed my life. I'll never be the same, and I don't want to be known by what my name is. I don't want to be known by who my family is. I don't want to be known by what tribe I'm from. I just want to be known by what happened to me down there at the Brooks of Gaash. Now you say, preacher, what happened to him? Well, I'm not sure, but I'm going to ponder a little bit if you'll allow me. I'm thinking about Gaash. I'm thinking about what the word means. The word, if you look it up in your Strong's Concordance, means a quaking or a cataclysmic event. It doesn't mean something just that happened just sort of along the way. It means something that is life-changing. And it's interesting to me about the Brooks of Gaash and the hills of Gaash, because a brook in our Bible, when you read about a brook, we might think about a little babbling brook. We might think about a little stream, but that's not a brook in the Bible. A brook in the Bible would be a place that normally, probably 90% of the time, is just dried up. It's just a low place in the land. But then when the rain comes and there's a torrential rain, that rain would come down off of the mountain and it would suddenly fill that brook, and all of a sudden there would be a movement of water through there, and it would be of such magnitude that we would call it a quaking. If you were in the way, you might just get washed away. And how natural it is that the Brooks of Gaash would be near the hills of Gaash. The rain would come down and fill the brook, and there would be a quaking. Now, I'm not preaching on this, but if I was to think about the Brooks of Gaash as the Word of God, I like it when all of a sudden I'm in my Bible. I'm not preaching on this. This is introduction. I'm not preaching on this, but I like it when I'm in my Bible and all of a sudden there's a quaking that comes through, and all of a sudden that brook gets filled up, and all of a sudden the Word of God washes over me and the Holy Ghost. I'm not preaching on that. I'd like to preach on that, but I'm thinking about this Brook of Gaash. Now, when we go to the brooks and think about brooks, I got several things I want to say to you, and then I'll make my point and I'll be done. When I read in my Bible, there are a lot of defining events in Scripture that took place connected with the brooks. Let me read some of them to you. Jacob wrestled with God at a brook. As a matter of fact, that's the first time we read about a brook in the Bible. David wept with his head covered because of the rebellion of Absalom. That was by the brook. Elijah waited for God at a brook while God was preparing him for the ministry. At a brook, Israel gathered branches of willows to worship the Lord. Lord during the Feast of Tabernacles. At the Brook of Eshcol, the Israelites gathered clusters of grapes to encourage the people to enter in the Promised Land. At the Brook, David gathered a handful of stones to destroy the giant Goliath of Gath. The faint in David's army rested at the Brook Bezor while David pursued and recovered their families. The godly King Asa burnt his mother's idol by the Brook of Kidron. The false prophets of Baal were slain by Elijah at the Brook of Kishon. Shimei violated the commandment of Solomon and crossed a brook and was put to death for it. Nehemiah went alone in the night to the Brook Kidron to view the walls, the broken walls of Jerusalem. Our Lord Jesus Christ crossed the Brook Kidron and entered into a garden to pray before being betrayed by Judas. All these things happened around the brook. The Lord did notable things by the brooks of Arnon. Here's what the Bible said. Wherefore it is said in the book of the wars of the Lord, what he did in the Red Sea and in the brooks of Arnon. The Lord led the children of Israel out of Egypt and into a land of brooks. Deuteronomy said, for the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of the valleys and hills. The Lord smote Arnon, Moab, and Mount Seir at the end of a brook. David referred to a brook in a picture of Christ's victory over his enemies. He pictures the Lord going along pursuing his enemies, and he has such victory, and he has such confidence. He stopped along the way and drank out of the brook while he was pursuing his enemies. The sons of Korah were instructed to use an image from the brook to illustrate their longing for God. As the heart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. Solomon used a brook as an illustration of the words of a wise man. The book of Job often speaks of the brooks as warning to the wicked. He said to him that is afflicted, pity should be showed from his friend, but he forsaketh the fear of the Almighty. My brethren have dealt deceitfully as a brook, as the stream of brooks that pass away. Whatever took place at this brook with this man, Hittai, I don't know what it was, but whatever it was, it caused him to forsake his past. It caused him to forsake his pursuits. It caused him to follow along a new path. And I'm thinking about this. Whenever you would talk to him, he'd say, let me tell you about what happened at the brook. Let me tell you what went on down at the brook. Let me tell you the story of the brook. He reminds me of the Apostle Paul. Whenever you talk to him, he'd say, let me tell you what happened on the Damascus Road. Let me tell you how I met Jesus every time he got a chance. You know what? I wonder if you have had tonight or this morning a life-altering experience, something that you'd want to be known by. And you know what I'm wondering? I'm wondering what you are known by. What are you known by this morning? What do you want to be known by this morning? What is it important to you that people would know about you? What is the defining moment of your life? I remember preaching in Tennessee. A lady came up to me after the service and said some things, you know, usual greetings and such. And she walked, and then she entered into a tirade about something that someone had done to her. And what had been done to her was terrible. And the person that did it shouldn't have done it. But she went on and talked about it. And finally, she left. And the next night, I went to preach. And after the sermon, she walked up. She greeted me again, and there she went again into that tirade about what someone had done. She talked about it, talked about how sorry they were. I was trying to get out of the conversation. I was trying to be polite, but I was slowly backing up, trying to get out of the conversation. She did it a third night, and I thought to myself, dear lady, I'm sorry for what's happened. I'm sorry for how you've dealt with. But you know what? It's all you're going to ever be known for. If it's all you talk about, if it's all you bring up, that'll be what everybody thinks about when they think about you. I don't want to be known by what someone has done to me. I don't want that to be the defining point of my life. I don't want it to be the purpose of my life to bring that up. I'm wondering, what is the defining moment of your life? Now, I could give you some things. I got some more things, but I'm going to give you this little thing, and I'm going to be done. The very first time that we read about a brook in the Bible has to do with Jacob. And Jacob is coming home, and he has to meet his brother, Esau. The last time he saw Esau, Esau was purposing in his heart to murder his brother. He had stolen his brother's birthright. You remember he snuck into the tent and got that blessing that he didn't deserve? And I just mentioned to you, he got it because he came in somebody else's name with the work of somebody else's hands wearing somebody else's clothes, which is the same way I got the blessing I didn't deserve. But he got that blessing and he left. And when Esau heard about it, Esau, he comforted his heart to kill his brother. And so Jacob has to leave. He goes to his uncle Laban's house. If there are ever two people in the Bible who deserved each other more than Jacob and Laban, I don't know who they were. They were con men. They conned one another. But then Jacob leaves and he takes his two daughters with him, or his two wives, Laban's daughters. He said, the Lord has told me to go home to my father. And it's interesting, those two girls never agreed on anything except one thing. Let's leave daddy. That's an interesting thing, isn't it? They fussed with each other about everything else, but when Jacob said, we're leaving your dad, they said, we're ready. You know what? I hope our children aren't waiting for the chance to get out of our houses. That's another message. Anyway, so he's coming home and he prays. He comes up with a plan. Jacob's got this plan. He sends gifts ahead to Esau. And then he sends his first wife ahead with her children. Then he sends his second wife ahead with her children. And then brave Jacob brings up the rear. And in the midst of his plan, he prays. Ask God to bless his plan. Isn't that like what we usually do? Lord, here's what I'm going to do. Will you get in on it? And then all of a sudden, while he's left alone by the brook, somebody jumps him. The Bible said there wrestled with him a man. He's wrestling. I was a wrestler in high school. I know what wrestling is about. So what is it? Control. That's what a wrestling match is about, control. If you control that other fella, you win. And so Jacob's in a wrestling match. He don't know who this is. He don't know if it's some assassin that is sent by Esau. He don't know what's going on. He just knows somebody's jumped him. I see him rolling around in the mud. I see him gouging. I see him reaching. I don't know what kind of moves they use, but they're rolling in the ground and they're wrestling. And Jacob's already worried about having to face his brother, and he's going to have to see his daddy. Now he's rolling with this man. They're wrestling away. And then all of a sudden, in the middle of the wrestling match, that opponent, that fellow that's wrestling him, touches him in the hollow of the thigh, and the sinew of his thigh shrinks, and Jacob becomes crippled. And suddenly Jacob's holding on for dear life. He's clinging. And while he clings, the angel, and you know what? Now he knows he's not wrestling some man. He knows he's wrestling somebody different than a man. Because a man couldn't give him with one touch and cripple him. And so now he's crippled, he's holding on, and it's the Lord. And the Lord said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And Jacob said, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. And I like the Lord's next statement to him, his question, what is thy name? The last time somebody asked him his name, he lied. You know what he does this time? He tells the truth. I'm Jacob. He might as well have said, I'm the swindler. I'm the con man. I'm the liar. I'm the deceiver. I'm the heel catcher. I'm everything my name means. And when he told the Lord what his name was, the Lord said, well, we're going to change it. If you tell the Lord what you are, he'll make you something else. And so he said, thy name shall be no more called Jacob. Actually, it goes like this. Thy name shall be no more Jacob. Don't you like that? No more Jacob. No more Jacob, but Israel, for as a prince with God, thou hast prevailed. He didn't prevail because he made God do what he wanted him to do. He prevailed because God prevailed over him. So here's the brook. They've been wrestling at the brook. And now this confident, brave Jacob gets up to walk away from the brook, and he walks like this. And I can see this Jacob walking away from the brook. And somebody says to him, what happened to you? Why do you walk like that? Well, let me tell you what happened back at the brook. Let me tell you, I had it all figured out. Let me tell you, I was confident. I had a plan, and God came in and my plan fell apart. And God touched me, and God made me something that I never was before. God made me something new. God made me no more Jacob and made me Israel as a prince with God. And he would walk along. He would limp along. He would limp on that leg. I could see him one day with his grandchildren, and he comes limping into the chair, and one of them grand youngins come up and crawls up into his lap, said, "Papa, why?" They're from the southern kingdom. Said, "Papa, why do you walk like that? Why do you walk like you walk?" He said, "Well, I'll tell you, honey, something happened to me one day. I had a meeting with God, and he touched me, and I ain't never been the same since, and that's why I walk the way I walk." And then one day, Jacob went to walk in to Pharaoh's household. He's going in, the Bible said, to bless Pharaoh. Imagine that. The little shepherd man's going to bless the king of the earth. The little fellow that's been following along behind the cattle going to bless the man who's dressed in gold and a crown. And you know what he does? He comes walking into the palace, and all along the palace are those idols. He's got to pass those soldiers. He's got to pass the guard. He's got to pass all those idols of Egypt. All those idols lined up over here, and all those idols lined up over there. And he's headed toward them doors, and he's going to go in and stand before Pharaoh. And every time he takes a step, listen to me, he's taking a step. And every time he takes a step, because of what happened at that brook, every time he takes a step, there's a shout that rings out. Because he's surrounded by gods who can't see, and he's surrounded by gods who can't talk, and he's surrounded by gods who can't hear, and he's surrounded by gods that can't move, and he's surrounded by gods that can't touch. But every time that old shepherd takes a walk and takes a step, every time he limps along, I can hear him shout out, "There is a God that can see, there is a God that can hear, there is a God that can talk, there is a God that can touch, there's a God who's not made of metal. There's a God who's not made of wood. There's a God who's not made of gold. There's a living God who will touch you at the brook, and your life will never be the same again." I think the rest of Jacob's life, he was known by what happened at that brook. And I'd like to be known for the rest of my life and all of eternity by what happened to me one day at Calvary, when the God of Israel, the Lord Jesus Christ, touched my life and made me different and made me brand new. You say, "Preacher, tell me about your life." Let me tell you what my life is all about, or should be all about, or what I want it to be all about. What happened at the brook when God saved me and changed my life. That's what Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Lord, help us not to make our life be about us, or what we do, or what we know, or what we think. Let us say, like John the Baptist, "He must increase, and I must decrease." I hope you've been to the brook. I was preaching up in Michigan in a camp meeting, and we were in Romeo, Michigan. We're at the old-fashioned Baptist camp meeting, but it was a Methodist campground, and they had a little museum in the back. And I went back there and looked. A.B. Simpson had preached in that. Some of you read some of his things, had preached in that campground. Others had preached, and they had pictures of some of the old preachers that had preached there. Some of them I've read after. And then they had some transcripts of some of the sermons. I'm going to tell you, there's some pretty good preaching went on there. Then in one of those transcripts at the end, it said this: "At the end of the service, during the invitation, four young men came forward and had an experience with the grace of God." I thought, you know, I'm not a Methodist. I'm an old-time independent fundamental Baptist, but I had that same experience. I had experience with the grace of God. I've been down the brook. I'm not what I used to be. I'm a new man in Christ. I want to be known by what happened to me that day when Jesus changed my life. I hope you've been to the brook. Let's pray. Father, we love you, and we thank you for loving us. And I pray you'll help us now in Jesus' name. Amen. Preacher, will you?